is he's showing us that he doesn't reveal all of himself to us at once because it would just be too much for us to handle. And so there are times where he allows for mystery because he can't reveal everything at once because we're not ready to handle everything at once. And to some degree, that's what we're talking about this morning. If you have been reading through the book of Leviticus with us, you will say, yes, God wraps himself in dark clouds because I get none of this, right? I hope that you have been reading along with us in Leviticus. This week we read chapters 8 through 14, and starting today, we'll 15 through 21 over the next few weeks, one chapter a day. We come in and we start to unpack this or part of this that we've been reading over the course of the week. So I hope that you're reading with us. Of all the exciting books that we can pick, we decided Leviticus right now, and it's really... Believe it or not, it is really exciting stuff. And I think you're going to see a portion of that again today, and it just is going to get better as we go over the next couple of weeks through this book together. And so we're calling this series Mosaic, and what we mean by that is nothing related to the guy Moses. It's actually about the artwork that's known as a mosaic. So if you look at a mosaic, it's got all these little glass pieces, and they're put in a certain order. If you get up really close to the mosaic and just look at one glass piece, you know, it looks like, that's nothing pretty. You know, it's just this awkwardly shaped piece of glass that's a little bit off color or whatever. But if you start to back up from there, you start to see a bigger picture and start to realize, wow, this is a beautiful piece of art that's happening here. And that's kind of the way that Leviticus works. If you read Leviticus, you're kind of getting up and up close and personal with like one or two little pieces of glass. And you look at it and you think, that's weird. Why is that there? But the more you back up, the more you start to see, wow, God is doing incredible things with this book of Leviticus. So as we get ready to jump in this morning, I want to ask you a question. And you don't need to answer out loud, but I just want you to get something in your mind. I want you to picture whatever the answer is to this for you. So here's the question. What are you really good at? If you had to, you know, look around the room and say, hey, I'm probably better than everybody else in this room at blank, what would it be? Maybe it's something related to your job. Maybe it's some knowledge that you have. Maybe you're an expert in some area. Maybe you have a talent, you know, you're a writer, you're a painter, you're an artist, or whatever it may be. But you might not be the best ever, but you know, you look at that thing in your life and you think, yeah, I'm pretty good at this. I do pretty well at this. Friend, I don't know how many of these people know here, and I don't know that Fran wants me to say this.
Go to Jack's.
Yeah, right. Fran, who's done such a good job filling in for us today while Randy's gone. Fran has some experience playing baseball, and actually some professional experience playing baseball. Fran, you were a pitcher, right?
Right.
Yeah, well, I have to tell you, I never, you know, aspired to be a Major League Baseball player or anything, but I was a pretty mean softball player back in my day. And yeah, this was, you know, like sixth grade and under, but as a church league. But I guarantee you there was a day and there was a time where, man, you pitched me a baseball, I couldn't hit it for anything, but you throw me a softball and I'll knock the cover off that thing, right? So there was a day when I was a kid and I kind of thought, yeah, I'm the best at this, you know, that kind of thing. You have something in your life. I don't know what it is, but something that you would say, yeah, I'm pretty good at that. So do you have that in your mind now, what that something is? All right, I'm going to try to do a mind-reading trick here for us. All right, so here's the thing. I'm just going to guess, all right? I'm going to guess that you did not say, I am the best one in here at following God. I'm going to guess that wasn't the first thing that came to mind for you, right? I'm going to guess you didn't look at your neighbor and think, yeah, they've come to church a few times, but I can run circles around them with Jesus. You know, that probably wasn't the first thing that came to mind for you is, boy, I'm a spiritual giant, and I can't wait to show that off. Most of us don't think that way, right? I guarantee you, even the guys that stand up here, if they think that way, you need to get rid of them. Something's going on, you know. Most people don't think, oh, I've got it made spiritually. I am, you know, me and God, you know, we're like this. We don't think that way because every one of us, if truth is told, every one of us have a past. Every one of us have things in our lives that we look at and we think, man, I wish that wasn't there. I wish I didn't get into that. I wish I had kept my mouth shut when I said that stuff. And by past, I also mean like yesterday or this morning on the way to church, right? Every one of us have these issues where we look at these things in our lives and we think, you know what? I'm good at some things. This is probably not an area where you want to call me an expert, you know? This is probably not the area where I look at my life and say I'm better at this than almost anybody else in the world being a follower of Jesus. That's normal. That's natural. That's part of how God has wired us. That's part of who we are. That's a good thing, right? We need humility to a degree. But what we're going to see today, if we open up the book of Leviticus, what you're going to see is that God comes to a few people in the community and says, I am appointing you to be spiritual experts. And for the rest of your life, everybody in the community is going to look at you and they're going to expect you to be the expert on connecting with me. And so I think you're going to see some pretty cool stuff related to that. Like I've told you, the book of Leviticus is so rich. It is. It really is, I promise. And we're going to unpack a little bit of that today. But before we jump into that, let me just remind you, in the book of Hebrews, last week we looked at Hebrews chapter 10 a little bit. And in Hebrews chapter 10, it tells us that all of this stuff that we're looking at in Leviticus, all of this stuff in the law, is not the reality that we should be paying attention to. It's the shadow of things to come. It's foreshadowing something better that's coming down the line. So Hebrews 10:1 says, the law, which Leviticus is the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. If you put that in very, you know, practical terms, if you look up here at me, if you can see on the floor in front of me, there's a shadow right here. That's my shadow. I don't think any of you would go around saying, yeah, I met John's shadow, and I know his shadow well, and so I feel like I've got a great relationship with John because I met his shadow. That would be weird, right? We don't do that. The shadow, though, points to a reality. It points to something else being present, something else that's coming, something else that's there. My shadow points to the reality of me. And what God is saying is, he's saying all of this law, all of this stuff in Leviticus, it's a shadow of something better that's coming, of a reality that's coming that will absolutely show you who I am and how to relate to me. So that's what we're looking at in the book of Leviticus as we start to open this up. So Leviticus chapter 8 is where we are. And if you want to open your Bibles, we'll just start in verse 1 in a second. But before we just dive in, let me remind you of how we got to this point. So Leviticus comes right after the book of Exodus. You remember the whole story of Exodus. Moses goes down to Egypt. God tells him to go to Pharaoh and say what?
Let my people go.
There you go. Let my people go. And so he does. He goes down. He says, let my people go. And Pharaoh says, yeah, right. You know, and all of these plagues happen. And eventually, even though Pharaoh doesn't want it to happen, they leave. The people of Israel get out of Egypt. That's where we get to the point where God takes them to the mountain that's called Sinai. And if you remember, that's where God gives them the Ten Commandments and things like that. And he literally speaks to them out loud from this mountain. God is present on the mountain, seen as a cloud and a fire on the mountain, and he speaks out loud, and the people of Israel look at God and they say, please don't ever do that again. That scared us to death. We don't want to hear you speak out loud. You just talk to this Moses guy and let him tell us what you said, right? And so for the rest of the book of Exodus, what God is doing is he's saying, okay, that's what I'll do, but I don't want this separation between us. I don't want this separation where I'm up here on the mountain and you're down here away from the mountain. So God says, just like you're living in tents, I want you to create and set up a tent for me to live in the middle of your community. And that's what we call the tabernacle, or the tent of meeting. And so God is literally hanging out in the community with these people. And the book of Leviticus is telling us, because God is living in your midst, this is how you have to live. This is how you connect to him. All right? So that kind of brings us up to date here. Leviticus chapter 8, Let's start in verse 1, and I'm gonna move quickly through the first part of this. We're gonna skip some verses and really spend some time on a few verses in the middle of the chapter. So here's what it says. It says, "The Lord said to Moses, bring Aaron and his sons, their garments, the anointing oil, the bowl for the sin offering, the two rams, the basket containing bread made without yeast, and gather the entire assembly at the entrance to the tent of meeting." Moses did as the Lord commanded him, and the assembly gathered at the entrance to the tent of meeting. Did any of you guys remember, we talked a little bit about this over the last few weeks. Do you remember how many people would have been hanging out with them in this assembly? It's like 2 million people, right? It's a lot of people. And so when God says to him, says to Moses, I want you to just round everybody up. Bring them out here and let's stand in front of the tent. That's a pretty big undertaking, right? When God says, get everybody out here and assemble in front of the tent, you just imagine. I mean, this is a little more than a pup tent, right? I mean, but it's still not this huge deal. Imagine gathering 2 million people to stand out here in this field in front of the church building. That would be crazy, right? But that's what God says. He says, I want everybody here because I want everybody to see what I'm about to do. He says, I'm about to set aside a couple of guys, a few guys, and I want the whole community to get this. Don't miss it. Don't stay back in your tent. Don't hang out and play a game somewhere else. Everybody come together because this is important stuff that you need to see. And so Moses does that. He gathers the entire assembly together in the front of the tabernacle. Verse 5 says, Moses said to the assembly, this is what the Lord has commanded to be done. Then Moses brought Aaron and his sons forward and washed them with water. All right, what's about to happen here is called an ordination. If you've been around churches for a while, you may have seen ordination services where somebody is ordained that's going to be a minister, or somebody is ordained that's going to be a deacon, or something like that. This is the first one ever. This is how God sets it up and says that it's supposed to work, right? So it's going to be an ordination service. And Moses is ordaining his brother, Aaron, to be the high priest, and his sons are going to be priests that work with him. All right, verse 7. So he's just washed them with water. Verse 7, he put the tunic on Aaron, tied the sash around him, and clothed him with the robe, and put the ephod on him. He also tied the ephod to him by its skillfully woven waistband, so it was fastened on him. He placed the breastpiece on him, and put the Urim and Thummim in the breastpiece. Then he placed the turban on Aaron's head, and set the gold plate, the sacred diadem, on the front of it, as the Lord commanded Moses. That make perfect sense to everybody? You know, we're all on the same page here, right? This is one of those passages where it's like, why do we need all of this stuff, right? Why do we need to hear about this breastplate and a ephod and a gold plate that's going to be on a turban? And what difference does this make? Why is God doing this? And before we kind of get into an answer for that, I want to just give you a visual of what this may have looked like. Now, this isn't an exact representation, but this is similar to what the high priest would have worn. This multicolored thing right here that looks like a backwards apron, that's the ephod. He had the blue tunic underneath that, under here. If you go to Exodus 28 and you can read about all the details, but it's got bells and pomegranates, and it's got the turban on his head, and this breastplate has 12 stones in it that each have one of the names of the tribes of Israel. So there's tons of symbolism here. And kind of the question is, how did Aaron get chosen to be the cool guy wearing the outfit? You know? How did he get to wear this special outfit versus everybody? And by the way, it is a pretty special outfit. The gold in the ephod and other places is literal gold that's woven into the fabric. So it's an expensive garment. It's one that sets him apart. And so the question is, you know, why and how did this happen? Did Aaron get chosen for this because he was a spiritual giant, because he was this elite guy that, you know, everybody saw God through Aaron? Is that how Aaron got chosen? I don't know if you remember it, but not too far before this, in the book of Exodus, there's a time where Moses is up on the mountain, he's spending time with God, and Aaron is down at the base of the mountain with all of the people, and they come to the conclusion, oh, that Moses guy, he must have died, and so we need to just go ahead and create our own gods. And so the way Aaron explains it to Moses is, I just collected all this jewelry from the people, I threw it into the fire, and pow, out came this cow. And so now we're worshiping the cow. Does that sound like the spiritually elite guy that we want to be the spiritual leader of the community? Right? Probably not. You know, this guy that totally got it wrong, the guy that, you know, looked at everybody around him and said, yeah, I guess the real God is gone, so let's make our own God. That doesn't sound like the best leader for, but somehow he gets chosen to be honored as the high priest and wear these this incredible outfit to display to the rest of the nation that he is their way to connect to God. I don't know about you, but for me, as one who has to stand in a priestly kind of role sometimes, I am very thankful for this. I am very thankful that Aaron blew it and got it wrong and had a past. Because you know what? I have a past, like all of us have a past, right? And the really cool thing is that God didn't come and say, well, because you have a past, you are worthless and you can't be used and I don't want you around here. No, God said, what I'm going to do is I am going to cover your past and I'm going to give you a position of honor. Did you deserve it? Did you earn it? No. But I'm giving you this position of honor because I believe that you want to point people to me. And that's the whole goal for the priest, by the way. The whole goal for the priest, and keep this in mind because we're going to keep coming back to it. Their role is to help people relate to God. Their role is to help people relate to God. And since he is in the camp with them, the priest is there to help them relate to God. And so Aaron is at this point where even though he's not done any great things to earn this title, God has come to him and said, I am covering your past. I'm going to honor you with this glory thing. And you're going to help people for the rest of your life come and relate to me in the right way. Keep that stuff in mind. That's going to be really important as we keep going. But if we just, we don't have time to read through all of this, but if we just kind of skip through some of it, eventually what happens is Moses comes and starts sacrificing animals on behalf of Aaron to get him prepared to be a priest. And the first sacrifice is in verse 14. It says, he, meaning Moses, then presented the bull for the sin offering, and Aaron and his sons laid their hands on its head. If you were here last week, you may remember that we talked about when people would come to offer sacrifices to God. What they would do is they would bring the animal, they would lay their hands on its head, and essentially they are transferring their brokenness, they're transferring their sinfulness onto this animal. And then the animal is slaughtered, and the blood of the animal covers the brokenness of the people. The death of the animal takes the place of the people who should have died for what they did, right? And so what's happening is, Moses gets this bull, Aaron brings this bull, and the first thing that they have to do, if this person is going to be a person that helps everybody else in the community connect to God in the right way, the first thing that needs to be done is they need to deal with his sin issue, with the brokenness issue. And so they slaughter this bull on behalf of Aaron and his sons as an offering to God so that they are covered when they come into the presence of God. If you keep going, in verse 18, there's another offering that takes place. It says, He, again Moses, then presented the ram for the burnt offering, and Aaron and his sons laid their hands on its head. If you remember, the burnt offering is an offering that is totally consumed. They don't take any of it out. They don't keep any of it and eat it. They put the whole thing on the altar, and it is fully consumed. And the picture here, now that they have come to God and they're covered by the blood, the next picture is this is how they're supposed to relate to God. That they will be completely consumed by God. That it's not going to be one of these, yeah, God, I want to follow you until I don't like what you say, and then I'm going to do my own thing, right? Or, God, I like the idea that you had, but I think I've got a better idea, so I think I'm going to do it my way. No, it's coming to God and saying, God, I am completely given to you. And that's what the second sacrifice is about. And then if we jump down to verse 22, this is where we're going to hang out for a few minutes. This is so rich. This is so good, guys. It says, he then presented the other ram, the ram for the ordination. Like I told you, this is the very first ordination service that ever happens. And Aaron and his sons laid their hands on its head. Moses slaughtered the ram and took some of its blood and put it on the lobe of Aaron's right ear, on the thumb of his right hand, and on the big toe of his right foot. Moses also brought Aaron's sons forward and put some of the blood on the lobes of their right ears, the thumbs of their right hands, and on the big toes of their right feet. Then he sprinkled blood against the altar on all sides. Don't you just read that and say, oh, that's good. That's good. It's one of those things, you know, you read it in the Bible, it's like, why in the world is this here? I don't get this, right? And I want to just stop for a second and unpack some of this, because this is important stuff that's going on. Now, first of all, just a clarification, why the right side? I mean, that may seem like that's really random, and why would you do that? What's the symbolism here? What's going on? If you pay attention to history or anything else, you may know that the right side is considered the side of honor. So in the Bible, another instance, example of this, Jesus comes, he dies for us, he's raised again, and Scripture tells us that after he's raised again, he goes back into heaven where he sits at the right hand of the Father, where he's interceding for us, he's praying for us. And so sitting at the right hand is a sign of honor. If you sit at the right hand of the king, you're his top servant. That's a place of honor and dignity, right? So the right side represents honor and dignity, among other things. That's one of the things that it represents. And so when they come and they place blood on the right side, again, what they're doing is they're saying they are giving these guys honor. And they do it in a specific way. So first of all, they slaughter the animal, they come and they place it, the blood, on the right earlobe. He said, why in the world do you put blood on somebody's earlobe? Alright? Again, it's a covering. It's their way of showing this is being made holy. And what do you do with your ear? You listen, right? So what he's showing them is he's saying, God gave you this position, and here's how you carry it out. The first thing that you need to do, the first thing that you need to know, is that your ears need to be attuned to the voice of God. You need to pay attention to what God is saying. If you're going to be able to help people relate to God, you have to be able to hear from God. And so that's the first thing that he shows them, is we are consecrating the ears of the priest so that they are ready to hear from God. And he goes on, and they put blood on the thumb of his right hand. And so the picture again is that just listening to God for this guy is not enough. It's not that you should just hear from God. You also need to have your thumb consecrated. And what would you do with your hands? You serve, right? Saying, not only are you to hear from God, but you're to serve these people. And when they come bringing these animals, these sacrifices, you're to be there to serve them as they sacrifice these animals to God so that they connect to God in the right way, so that they relate to God properly. And so he shows them, you're to be a person of not only hearing from God, but also a person who serves others with God. And then he comes in and they have the feet, and I don't know if you would have noticed this, but the priests aren't wearing shoes. Now, it would have been normal to wear sandals in this time, right? But the priest isn't wearing shoes. Why would that happen? If you remember back a little bit, you remember the story of Moses when he runs into this bush that's burning out here in the middle of nowhere, and he thinks, that's weird. He goes over to look at it. God speaks to him from the bush, and you remember what God says to him? I want you to take off your shoes because you're standing on holy ground. And so these priests are not wearing sandals because they are standing on holy ground. They are with God. And why does he choose the big toe? Here's my logic. Here's my reasoning. I think God is telling us very clearly here that he doesn't want anything to do with the toe that goes wee, wee, wee all the way home. No. Corny preacher. Sorry. That's no. I don't know exactly why he picks the big toe, but I've been told that the big toe is kind of what leads the way. That's what points in the direction that you're going to go, right? So it's leading the way. But what it's representing is through the rest of life, as you do life, you are to walk with me. You're to walk with God. And everything that you do day after day after day after day, you do it walking with God. And so these men have been set apart. They have been proclaimed the spiritual leaders. And God says, as the spiritual leaders, you need to hear from me well. You need to serve with me well. You need to walk with me day after day after day. Now, if we go back, I told you right at the beginning that all of this is a shadow, right? All of this is preceding something better that's coming. So who is it talking about that's supposed to be this one that has his ears attuned to God and his hands given in service to God and his feet walking with God? If you were to answer Jesus, that would be the right church answer like 99% of the time. But that's not the answer here. Now, you may say, but Jesus is our high priest. And I remember reading in the book of Hebrews that he is, you know, the high priest over us, and that's why we don't have all of this anymore, these sacrifices. And you would be exactly right, but what Hebrews tells us is that Jesus does not come from Aaron's line. Jesus comes from a line of priests, from a guy that is known as Melchizedek. And we don't have time to get into all of that right now, but basically what it's saying is that the shadow that's being presented here is not a shadow of Jesus coming, it's something else. So who is he talking to? Who's the priest that's supposed to have their ears attuned to God and their hands given to God and their feet walking with God day after day? Let me just read two verses actually to you from the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. This is Peter, the same disciple that walked with Jesus for all of those years. He's writing later in life to the Jewish Christians. So to people who would understand all this Leviticus stuff, right? And he says this is so good, this is so good. He says in verse 4, as you come to him, meaning come to Jesus, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house or spiritual temple. So get the picture in your mind. What he's saying here is he's saying God no longer lives in a tent in the community. He's saying God dwells in the midst of us, of his believers. We are the ones that create, essentially, the temple. We are the temple today, right? God dwells in the middle of his people. And then, listen to this. It says, so again, verse 5, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So, if all of this stuff about being a priest is not a shadow of the coming of Jesus, and if Peter says, you who are the believers are being built into a priesthood, who is this talking to? It's talking to us. It's saying all of this routine, all of this ritual, all of this ear and thumb and toe stuff, it's about us. And you may say, I don't want to be a priest. I'm not good at that kind of stuff. And I would say, I don't want to be a priest. I'm not. But God says, you are all priests. You are being built into this nation of priests. And so he says, here's the thing, and here's the big idea that I want you to take home with you today. Here's the thing. Our role as believers is to help people relate to God. We tend to think our role is to come and to make sure I'm here on a regular basis. And maybe I give a little bit in the offering plate, or, you know, maybe I'm nice to people, whatever. We tend to think that's our role. And God comes along and he says, here's your role. You are my priest to the world. You're the one that helps them understand how to relate to me properly. And you say, how do I do that? I've never been to seminary. I've never been to Bible school. I don't know how to connect people to God. And God says, it's really easy. Just remember this. Ear, thumb, and toe. Ear, thumb, toe. Ear, thumb, toe. If you keep that in mind, you got it. So first of all, the ear, right? He says, I want you to have your ears open to me. That's why we do this every single week, right? This is a place where we can come together as a community and hear from God, connect to God. But this isn't the only place. I mean, if you go home this afternoon and you sit down and you open the Bible and you start reading, you're hearing from God. This is God speaking to you. This is his language. You may say, I don't know how to hear from God. This is where it starts, guys. And God is telling us in all of life, I want you to hear from me. I want your ears to be open to me so that you can know exactly what I'm saying to you. I don't care about your past. I know you have a past. I know you've got things that you say, but what about this? But what about this? God says, I have put you in a place of honor because you have faith in me. I want you to hear from me. And then he goes on and says, not only are you to hear from me, but as my priest, I want your hands and your lives to be given in service to me. I've told some of you guys this before, but when we first were getting started here at Trailhead, we had a few services that we just called preview services. We actually did three of them, and it was really to kind of get our feet under us and get ready to start having public services. And so the first preview service we ever did, we already had growth groups meeting at the time, and there were about 30 people in those groups. And so we basically just said, you can only come to the preview service if you're a part of the growth groups, if you're a part of our community groups, because we know we're going to get it wrong, we know we're going to mess stuff up, and so these are people that we know are nice enough that they're not going to hold that against us. And so we didn't invite anybody else. And so our first preview service, we had about 30 people, and that includes kids that were here for our service. Second preview service that we ever had, we said, okay, we feel like we're getting our feet under us. So we started letting people know. We put an ad out on Facebook. We started telling people. We started doing all of these things to let people know we're about to have a service here. We want you to be a part of it. And you know how many people we had show up at that? Yeah, like 35. I mean, went through all of this stuff, and like nobody else shows up, and we're thinking, oh boy, this is going to be an interesting ride. And then we did our third preview service, which was Christmas Eve, December 24th, 2016. And, you know, if anybody's going to come to a service, Christmas Eve would be the time that they would come. And so we again started letting people know. In our third preview service we had, including kids, we had 77 people. So we had a decent uptick. But 77 people, if you take everybody in this room and then include the kids that are back there, that's, close to 77 people probably. And so, it's not like just a overflowing number, but it's a decent number, right? In spite of that, we felt like God wanted us to start with two services. Now, if you take those 77 and say, they actually all came back, and then divide them in half for two services, you got two pretty small services, right? There were two reasons that we did that. First of all, we did that because we believed that God was doing something and that more people were coming. We really believed that. But the second reason that we did that, and this holds true to this day, is because we wanted people understand that you should come to listen in one service and connect with God. But there's a second service that's available for you to come and serve as well, to be a part of helping people relate to God more than just sitting in a room. That's why we started with two services. That's why we're at the place that we're at. And guys, it is our goal, it is our desire that every single person that comes to Trailhead would get to a place where we are coming and listening, worshiping one service. We are coming, serving one service. Because we are not carrying out everything that God has called us to do until we are doing these three things, until we've got the ear and the thumb and the toe. We're not carrying it out until we have all three. You may remember, some of you have heard us talk about our vision statement before. It starts off by saying that we want to demonstrate the love of God to every new resident of Wellington. And then the second half of it, this is what applies today, says, and we want to immerse every active attender in the Jesus way of life. And you might have looked at that in the past and thought, what is the Jesus way of life? How does that work? That seems out there somewhere. I'm not sure how to pull this all in. Here it is. Here's the Jesus way of life. Ear, thumb, and toe. That's the Jesus way of life. Listen to God intently. Serve people regularly. Walk with God daily. And that's the third part of this. Is if we're going to be the church that God wants us to be, we're going to be people that have our feet consecrated, that we're walking with God day after day after day. And the way that we do that here at Trailhead, again, you may say, well, that sounds nice. What does that mean? The way that we do that at Trailhead is we are driven by four core values. We're driven by four things that we believe if we live these out in everyday life, then we are walking in the Jesus way of life. So here they are. First core value is lifestyle hospitality. What we mean by that is as you do life, as you go through your day-to-day existence, invite people into your circle. Invite people into your circle. The way that we say it is we want you to invite people into your family before you invite them into your faith. And that's the first core value. That's the first way we walk this out. The second way is what we call servant generosity. And we say we want to serve people. We want to love them well and we want to serve them. Even if they don't deserve it. We want to be generous to people, even if they don't deserve it. You know why? Because that's exactly what God does for us. The third thing we say is we want to be people who are known for patient persistence. We want to be people who are known for patiently and persistently learning the ways of God and following the ways of God. We want to be patient, persistent in the way that we relate to people. Even when they get on our nerves, we're going to love them anyway, right? And then we talk about fourth, continual multiplication, meaning we don't ever want to stop making disciples. We don't ever want to stop raising leaders. We don't ever want to stop multiplying groups and even churches. We want to continually multiply. And so what I believe the scripture is saying to us today is it's saying our role as believers is to help people relate to God. And the way that we do that is through our ears, through our thumbs, and through our toes. Through our ears, through our thumbs, and through our toes. Guys, we will never be the church that God desires for us to be if we are a church of only ears. That's a great thing. But the problem with the church in America is that we have become a church of ears, where we are happy to sit in rows and where we're happy to come and make sure that we're here. And yeah, I'm hearing from God. This is great. But God says that's not the whole picture. If you're just hearing, you're missing the thumb. You're missing the toe. And we need a thumb. We need a toe. We need a bunch of them. I know that sounds weird, but we need everybody to have thumbs and toes engaged in the game. This is so rich. God is saying, here is the thing. I want you to be the kind of church. I want you to be the kind of people that you know me because you're regularly listening to me through my word, through the church, through prayer. You're regularly listening to me. You're regularly serving the people around you. And day after day after day, you're walking with me in this Jesus way of life. I love this because it's just so easy to remember. Ear, thumb, toe, ear, thumb, toe. God, am I doing what God wants me to do? Ear, thumb, toe. Am I walking in the path that God wants me to walk in? Ear, thumb, toe. Am I carrying out what I should be carrying out as an active attender at Trailhead Church? Ear, thumb, toe. Our responsibility, our role as believers is to help people relate to God.